I was a senior in high school, and I had just started the fall quarter for 3 months, and was into that, and I had a lot of part-time jobs. I painted houses, and at that particular Sunday, December 7th, I was building a fence for a neighbor who lived about 1 mile away up at Alki Point, and I was surprised to look up and find that my then-girlfriend, Helen Bross, who's been my wife almost ever since, come walking down the sidewalk, and she lived 3.5 miles away, and she had walked that distance and came down to Alki to inform me that the Japanese had bombed Pearl Harbor. Anyway, I had met Helen earlier in the year in September when school took up, and we met in our Spanish class, and So we were dating, and we went to dances, and I had a friend that had a car, and I was one of 5 guys who owned his own car at West Seattle High School that year. President Roosevelt actually declared war the following day against Japan and Germany. Within a week, we were in a total blackout mood in all cities in the United States. There were no lights allowed outdoors after dark. They thought that they had no idea where the Japanese were in the Pacific, and they thought if this huge force that had attacked Pearl Harbor had come to the West Coast, there was every chance that they might launch some kind of a strike. It was totally serious. War was not, as we understand it today, something that's happening involving 1% of our population. Total war is difficult to imagine today because it's been 50 years or more since we've actually been involved in a total war. Everything has been rather regional now. But in a world war, it took every effort of the United States, and all civilian activities were curtailed. All production went into war material. I should mention that President Roosevelt had gotten a draft law through Congress in about 1939. That call for a registration of all males over 18 years old. I think you asked me earlier if, you know, if we were all frightened and whatnot. Well, it wasn't like there wasn't anything to fear. We were not going to be all killed in 3 weeks. They didn't have atomic weaponry then. We just knew we were in for a serious battle with the Japanese and the Germans on 2 fronts. Later on in the war, there were 16 million Americans overseas. The American deaths totaled 5,800 a month for 3 years. 10% of all American families lost a member in World War II. And it was very serious business. You didn't consider civilian activities as very important. Everything was what we call the war effort, and we even rationed our food and gasoline. And matter of fact, Helen went to work for Boeing when I went overseas, and one of her primary duties was to set up all new employees into the ride pool. You were actually looked down on, or people would turn you in if you were riding around in your own car as just a single person. Then my dream took wing. I knew I was going to be involved. I was just that age. I enlisted in the fall of 42, 3 months after I graduated from high school. I sandwiched in 1 quarter at the University of Washington. My father had been an infantryman in World War I, and he thought that was the only branch of the service to be in, and I didn't care to march through Indochina or across Europe on foot, so I thought being in the Air Force would be a better proposition for my situation. I qualified to go to flight school as a for pilot training, but there were no classes open at that time, and I was told that although I was a member of the Army, that I was to go home and I would be identified, or I'd be advised when to report for duty. Was very excited, of course, about, I'd never even ridden in an airplane at that time and had no idea what it was like, and it was all going to be a new experience for me, which it was. I didn't have any training to do any civilian jobs in the war effort, so I was bound for the service like 9 out of every 10 American youth at the time. I went to pre-flight, which was the same as Army basic training, down for the first 3 months in the Army down at Santa Ana, California. We were extensively questioned by psychiatrists who got extremely personal in their interviews, but they were really delving into your background as well as your mental attitudes concerning just all facets of life. You got up at 5:30 in the morning, fell out and answered a roll call, and then were dismissed right away to go back in and put your barracks back together, which was bed making and all that, and latrine duties and all. Then probably 40 minutes or something, and you fell out again, and then you were marched off to breakfast. We never sauntered anywhere for the first year I was in the Army. I never moved from one building to another without being in formation, marching, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, everybody in step. And in at pre-flight in California, there were no airplanes at Santa Ana Army Air Base at all. It was just 20,000 cadets being examined and classified. I was assigned to primary flying school at Phoenix, Arizona. It was called Thunderbird Number 2. We had a 1 mile square blacktop field. I was given approximately 6 hours of dual instruction where I was flying a Stearman PT 13 or 17 with a pilot instructor in the back seat. I flew about half of my time through primary flying school solo or by myself. The other half, of course, with the instructor who taught me all the basics of flying. At the end of primary, I was sent down to Marana, Arizona, which is near Tucson. And for 3 months down there, I flew the AT-6, which was a single-engine fighter trainer. So I was lucky I got into that. And so I figured I would be a single-engine fighter pilot. I found out the day after I graduated what kind of a plane I would be flying in combat, and I was extremely unhappy because I was assigned as a B-17 co-pilot, but we didn't know at that time that we were graduating just 6 months before the invasion of Europe, and they were going to need more bombers, more bomber crews and pilots and gunners and the whole works. So I was put together with 9 other people and who formed our combat crew. And then we had to go another 3 months down to Ardmore, Oklahoma, where we flew the B-17 approximately 150 hours as a crew. Paul Feese of Portland, Oregon, who was in a pilot class, one class ahead of me, became the first pilot of our crew. And I was the co-pilot. And we had a bombardier, a navigator, and then we had six gunners throughout the plane who, one was a radio operator, one was the chief engineer, and the rest of duty was primarily firing machine guns at incoming fighters that might attack us. We were then transported to Kearney, Nebraska. That's when Helen and I separated for my overseas assignment. She and I had been married on January 7th of 1944, and we had lived together for approximately 5 months. The Germans occupied all of Europe and except England. They even occupied all of North Africa across to, including Egypt. Nation was faced with the problem of supporting two separate wars in two huge locations. We were put aboard trains for New York City, and everything was very secret. In that 10 days we were at Kearney, we actually mounted trains three different times in two different types of uniforms, one for all summer lightweight gear, and then if you were going to Europe, you had to have heavy woolen gear. The first time we got aboard the train, we just got on and sat in the train for about an hour, and they said, okay, everybody off, turn in those lightweight uniforms you got, and we'll reissue you other stuff. So then we're all saying to each other, oh, God, we're going to Europe, you know, and not the Pacific. And it didn't make much difference. It was going to be combat against the Japanese or the Germans, no matter which way you went. In the 7 days it took us to get to New York, because we went up into Canada first and came back to the States at Buffalo, I guess we couldn't be traced where we were going. We were almost coal black from the 7 days in this thing, going through tunnels and whatnot. The car would fill up with coal smoke. And it was most uncomfortable, and we just whiled away the hours on the train playing poker and whatnot. We were assigned a hotel room in New York City, just six blocks off Times Square, and everybody jumped in the shower. We all looked halfway decent again. And we were in New York for five wonderful days before we went overseas. All we had to do was report to the hotel desk in the lobby at 6 in the morning and 6 at night to find out if we were on orders to go. And on the sixth day, they told us to jump in the bus. It was parked Army bus out in front of the hotel, and it took us to LaGuardia Field. And we went aboard a C-54, which was then an airliner. We spent about an hour on the ground refueling in Stephenville, Newfoundland. And two young kids, about 12 years old, came out to the plane with a red wagon full of freshly boiled lobsters and wanted a dollar a piece for them. We went back and made a dining room on the floor in the back of the plane. And in a few minutes, the pilot came back and said, you guys are going to have to move up forward. I can't get the nose down. You're all in the back. So we're not going to make it to Europe in this nose-high attitude, so we did want to make it. We knew we were out in the mid-Atlantic anyway, and so we took his advice and went on and landed in Prestwick, Scotland. Interesting item, we were at Prestwick, Scotland, had just been there long enough for them to take our American money away from us and in exchange giving us English pounds and pence and whatnot. And air raid siren went off. And we really thought we had caused a big stir in Europe to have an air raid siren go off. And it seems that a German propaganda plane had flown over and dropped leaflets, and pretty soon it looked like it was snowing lightly. And so we all picked them up and tried to save them for souvenirs, but we were herded into bomb shelters, and we were in there for about a half hour before the all clear was sounded. But we thought, that's kind of a quick introduction to being overseas. Our crew went to the 95th Bomb Group, as were two or three other crews that we had become acquainted with, and we were assigned to different squadrons there. When we got there, they said, okay, we're at Horam. And we are. Where is everything? We looked out, and the 95th Bomb Group was stationed there at Horam, and it was known as Station 119. All of the quarters were Quonset huts, temporary army type, half round corrugated metal. We were there at the 95th Bomb Group to do our business, and we actually started flying about between 3 weeks and a month after D-Day. And so we actually flew our first combat missions in early July of 1944. The common run of our missions started for us about anywhere from 2 o'clock in the morning on, but usually before 2:30, because we had to get up in our squadron area, get dressed, be hauled to the mess hall, and then to the flight line. And at the flight line, we went into a briefing room. If we were putting up 36 planes that day, there'd be 360 of us in the room, 10 guys from each plane. We just sat down like we were in a theater, and we had a stage, and above the stage was a huge map of Europe, and was covered with a curtain. We then learned what target we were going to when they opened the curtain and exposed the map that had been made up during the night before. And they ran ribbons of our course from Horam across the North Sea if we were going to Germany. And the ribbon would go and copy our course to the target.
Were some targets less popular than others to bomb, or did it matter?
Oh, some of them scared the daylights out of you. They, for instance, being assigned to attack the largest oil refinery in Germany at the Luena oil plant at Merseburg, Germany. It had 360 guns at the target, so you were going to expect terrific flak, and you were going to lose some airplanes. And we all knew it. You just accepted it and hoped for the best. Then we got in the plane and followed the timetable for the mission. A cannon would go off that would shake everybody at the air base, and that was the taxi time. We would take off three planes on the runway at a time. One plane would start the minute his tail left the ground and came up. The second man started. By then, the other plane was three-quarters of the way down the runway, and he was going, and we'd all move up on the runway, and then when the plane in front of us lifted its tail off the ground, we poured full coal on all four engines, and away we'd go. And so you're going up and up and around at the same time, right over your station. Because there were 40 bomb groups in East Anglia that were putting up planes. So we had all these planes going up at once. We encountered fighters on one-third of our missions. Now, that's I only flew 33 missions, so that you know, 10 or 12 times we were attacked by fighters. The Germans attacked the poorest formation flying groups because they could fly in closer to you, and a lot of them came up in front of us and did a roll, fired into you, and then went below you because the bottom of the German fighters were well armored, had steel plates on the bottom to deflect our many bullets that were flying out of all those 13 guns from each plane in our formation, and you could sometimes see the tracers ricocheting off the bottom of the German fighters that were getting hit but not knocked down. But they'd roll up in front of you, fire at you, and then pass under you, and then go down and come back up again and be back. All ME-109s, that's a Messerschmitt, and Focke-Wulf 190s. That's the only ones we ever saw until in September we saw the first, might have been late August, the first German jet fighter, which was the German, the ME-262, which confused us because it looked like a rocket leaving a trail of smoke behind and climbing way above us, and then come back down, usually just for one pass at us, and then they go back and land.
So, I mean, how scary was that, really?
It was scary as all get out, is the only way I can describe it, because when a fighter rolls up in front of you and you see the blinking lights on his wings, which are the explosions from the machine guns that he had maybe six of, and he's flying right at your windshield, and you know slugs are coming your way, and you're trying like the devil to concentrate on your flying job and flying for proper formation, and you just had to ignore the fact that something might come through the windshield at any second, and your heart was kind of close to your mouth.
Yeah.
It was very tiring by the end of the day. It was, you know, we weren't attacked all day. We were just attacked for maybe 5 minutes by a whole bunch of fighters, and then they'd be gone down to refuel, and they'll be back. We'll see them later, maybe on our way back home from the target to England.
And it was cold, right?
Oh, extremely cold, especially in the winter. It was freezing on the ground. And the temperature reduces 2% per 1,000 feet. So we were flying at 26,000 feet. We wore silk gloves on our hands under our flying gloves so that we could touch metal objects in the plane without sticking to them. You couldn't touch them with your bare fingers because you'd just become part of them and be frozen and stuck and of no use to anybody. So. Very cold. I've seen it minus 56 degrees below centigrade. Big icicles would form just from the exhaust of our oxygen masks going up and striking the radio, which was mounted on the ceiling. We'd get icicles 6-8 inches long hanging off of it, and we'd take turns knocking the icicles down so to keep our visibility. Not just the cabin, but the entire airplane was not pressurized. And we got up to 25 or 6, 7,000, and you could die in 3 minutes without oxygen.
Was anyone on any of your flights ever injured?
Yeah, the ball turret gunner was very seriously injured when his left arm was shot off at the shoulder. We had morphine, and we gave him a morphine shot about every 30 minutes to keep him basically unconscious. And he survived and returned to work in the oil fields of Texas after the war, I understand.
So you want to tell me about the most difficult mission that you flew?
Yeah, the most difficult was a trip to Hamburg one day. We went there to bomb the waterfront. At the target, we had an anti-aircraft shell explode immediately below our airplane, and apparently it took out the fuel lines to the engines on the left side of our plane, and we lost the power on both of them. My crew got busy and disconnect and got the ball turret gunner out of the ball turret and then dropped it. And we entered the North Sea area at about, I would imagine, about 20,000 feet. And we stabilized the plane. Both Paul and I held the right rudder completely into the right to keep the left wing up. So we were losing about 200 feet a minute as we flew towards England. We figured we'd probably have to ditch in the North Sea someplace because we were a couple hours away from our home station. But we nursed it all the way and we crossed the English coast at 500 feet of altitude, and ours. The base at Horam was only about 10 miles in from the coast, and so we just made a quick straight-in approach to the runway and was able to land wheels down. We were really tired. We'd been holding that left wing up. It felt like we'd been doing it together, Paul and I. That happened to us on one other mission also when we took part in the breakout from Normandy of the ground troops. We bombed a panzer division that was holed up in a forest at the town of St. Lô, which was just ahead of where the troops landed on the beach in Normandy. We went down there and bombed that panzer division with about 500 B-17s and enabled General Patton and his 3rd Armored Division to break out and head for Germany. So it was a turning point in the war in Europe. We later flew across St. Lô, and we could see where we had bombed because 500 B-17s went 2 days in a row and dropped on that one division of, it was called a Panzer Division, and the ground looked like it had been plowed. And I understood that the few survivors of that panzer division were just babbling idiots when they were taken into custody. They just had too much. And lucky to be alive, I think we probably killed 3,000 or 4,000 of their troops. But that's war. And the Russians were coming at the same time through Poland from the east side. So we knew the war would probably be over in the spring or summer of 1945, which was a year from when we started over there. A combat tour for all flying personnel was 25 missions. When you finished those, you were automatically became a member of the Lucky Bastards Club, and you were sent home. Or you could volunteer to stay and serve longer on a combat crew if you wished to, but very few volunteered for more because 25 missions were plenty. And it was all based on our losses. We lost 4% of our airplanes every day. And that's why they said, if you fly 25 missions, you will have used up all your luck. When the losses went down to 3%, they raised the required number to 30. We were a lead crew before we finished. We led the entire group and the entire division and the entire Air Force twice during our last 5 missions we flew. when it became 35, I went to our CEO and asked him for a break, and he reduced our required number to 33. And we flew until November 17th in 44. Well, when we finished and became lucky bastards and sent home, we boarded an Army transport ship, a 500-foot ship called the Santa Rosa, which was a Grace liner assigned to the Navy. We sailed the next morning from England and 17 days later landed in Boston. Missed Christmas by 2 days. We were still 2 days out of Boston on Christmas 44. But anyway, I arrived 3 days later, 4 days later in Fort Lewis with my complement of, I think, 34 troops. And then called Mom, and I don't remember how I got home that night. I think it took a taxi cab from Fort Lewis to Seattle. Helen was then living with her folks, and so we were reunited on the front porch. I was ready to go home. It just felt great to be out of the service, which is a little bit like being in prison, because 24/7, we didn't have any long leaves. I got a 10-day leave when I came home from overseas. And I got 10 days down at Santa Monica, and that's about the only time I had off for 2.5 years. I was downtown Seattle getting my discharge copied on VE Day, VJ Day, when the war ended against Japan and World War II was completely over. But it was just a marvelous feeling to have the whole thing behind you, and I was ready to go back to school and continue my life. Yeah, when you're in a total war like that for 3 solid years, why, the sooner it ends, the better.
Did you lose some friends in the war?
Oh, yeah. A matter of fact, Helen and my best man, he didn't survive. He was shot down over the Adriatic Sea between Italy and Yugoslavia. But I would say probably I knew 15 people that were killed during World War II as had been friends. Yeah.
Did that affect at all the way you felt about the whole thing? Or?
Oh, I think it changes your perspective in life completely. I mean, you're just so glad to be done with it, and it was a terrible experience, really. And we're just ready to get on with civilian life and forget the war, which we pretty well have, although you never do, because it was too earth-shaking. Yeah, I didn't have any choice. Missions that you go on or anything. I chose to be in the Air Corps, and I know that I'm partially responsible for killing a lot of people. Fortunately, it was not like being in the infantry where you're face-to-face shooting guys back and forth. So, no, it's I was able to pretty well forget it and go on with my life. I took part in the sweep across Europe into Germany and away from the beachhead at Normandy.
And you were awarded what medals?
Oh, I had the European Theater with 3 battle stars for Northern France, Germany, and Southern France. And I had 4 air medals, and the Distinguished Flying Cross was my highest honor. And so I had a satisfying experience, I guess you could say that, but war is so terrible, especially a total war and, like that involving, I think it was 150 or 130 to 150 nations involved in World War II. A quarter of a million American kids that got killed just didn't get the pleasure of raising a family that I did. Yeah, that's about it. I'm Dwight Stevens of Shoreline, Washington, and I was in the service for 1 month short of 3 years. And during that time, I took part in the battle for Europe.
Again, don't know where.